भगवते वासुदेवाय। रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम थर्ड कैंटो चैप्टर 23 टेक्स्ट नंबर 17 टू 21 21 इज ऑन द बोर्ड ऑल ऑफ द साइड ऑफ दी 17 तत्र तत्र विनिक्षिप्त नाना शिल्पो पशोपितं महामर्कट स्थल्य जुष्टं विद्रुमा वेदिभिः। Its beauty was enhanced by artistic engravings here and there on the walls. The floor was of emerald with coral daisies. But at the present moment, people are very proud of their architectural art, yet floors are generally decorated with colored cement. It appears, however, that the castle constructed by the yogic powers of Kardamamuni had floors of emerald with coral daisies. 18 द्वाशु विदुर्मा देहल देहल्या भातं वज्र कपाटवत् शिखरेषु इन्द्रनिलेषु हेमा कुम्भे उपनिषितम्। The palace was very beautiful with its coral thresholds at the entrances and its doors bedecked with diamonds. Gold pinnacles crowned its domes of sapphire. 90 Chakshumat Padmaraga Agriyai Vajra भूषिता निर्मितैः जुष्टं विचित्र वितने महारेम तोरणैः। With the choicest rubies set in the diamond box, it appeared as though possessed of eyes. It was furnished with wonderful canopies and greatly valuable gates of gold. Artistic jewelries and decorations giving the appearance of eyes are not imaginary. Even in recent times, the Mughal emperor constructed their palaces with decorations of 12 birds with eyes made of valuable stone. The stones have been taken away by the authorities, but the decorations are still present in some of the castles. Constructed by Mughal emperors in New Delhi, the royal palaces were built with jewels and rare stone resembling eyes, and thus at night they would give off reflective light without need of lamp. 20 Hamsa Parvata Vrtates Tatra Tatra Nikunjitam कृतिमान मन्यमानान स्वां अधिरुह्य अधिरुह्य च। Here and there in that palace were multitudes of live swans and pigeons, as well as artificial swans and pigeons, so lifelike that the real swan rose above them again and again, thinking them live birds like themselves. Thus the palace vibrated with the sounds of these birds. 21 Vihara Sthana Vishrama Vihara Sthana Vishrama Samavesha Prangana अजिरैहि समवेश प्रांगणा अजिरैहि यथोपजोषम् रचिते यथोपजोषम् रचिते विष्मानम् इव आत्मनः विस्मापनम् इव आत्मनः विहारस्थान विश्राम समवेश प्रांगणे अजनैः यथोपजोषम् रचे रचते विस्मापनम् इव Sthana, pleasure grounds, Vishrama, resting chambers, Samavesha, bedrooms, Tangana, inner yard, Ajiraihi, with outer yards, Yatha, Upajosham, according to comfort, Rachitaihi, which were designed, Vishmapanam, causing astonishment, Iva, indeed, Atmanaha, to himself, Kardama. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation. The castle had pleasure grounds, resting chambers, bedrooms, and inner and outer yards, designated with an eye of to comfort. All this caused astonishment to the sage himself. Kindly repeat the translation. The castle had pleasure grounds, resting chambers, bedrooms, and inner and outer yards, designed with an eye to comfort. All this caused astonishment
astonishment
to the sage himself.
Or
quote by Srila Prabhupada ki, Kardama Muni, being a saintly person, was living in a humble hermitage. But when he saw the palace constructed by his yogic powers, which was full of resting rooms, rooms for sex enjoyment, and inner and outer yards, he himself was astonished. That is the way of a God-gifted person. A devotee like Kardama Muni exhibited such opulence by his yogic power at the request of his wife. But when the opulence was produced, he himself could not understand how such manifestations could be possible. When a yogi's power is exhibited, the yogi himself is sometimes astonished. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Dhanandana Shalakaya Chakshurun Milikam Jena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Krishnaya Bhutale Shri Mate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Prasarine निर्विशेषन्यवादि पाश्चात्य सकालिने जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासवि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे So here we find, after it was described that the palace, the castle which Kardama Muni had made by his mystic power, which was floating in the sky, and it had several buildings, several stories in it. Now further, it is described about how opulent that castle was. Today, we are very proud of our development, of our modern technology with which we make so many things comfortable in our life. And actually, that is the whole purpose of material science, to exploit material nature for sense gratification. But if we compare with how the Vedic life was, we can see that advancement is very gross. There was much better advancement, even materially, in the Vedic times. Just like, say, for example, in the modern times, now we are seeing there are different countries who are practically at the threshold of world war. There is a chance that several countries may get together and World War III may be there. And it is said that if this time the world war happens, then practically the population from the earth can be wiped away. Because we have something called atomic bomb, we have something called nuclear bomb, which can produce so much devastation that even innocent people can be wiped away. Now, if we compare this technology with the kind of advancement in the Vedic system, we find that there was something called Brahmastra, which did not require so much of heavy scientific research, so many chemicals to be utilized. Just by chanting mantras, they were able to produce Brahmastra. And Brahmastra was so specific that it would not go and kill so many innocent people. It would go to the target particularly where it is meant for. Just like we find Ashwathama, he released Brahmastra to kill Maharaj Parikshit in the womb of his mother. And the Brahmastra went directly to the womb. Then the Lord, by his mystic power, appeared and saved Maharaj Parikshit. There used to be Brahmastra, and there also used to be another kind of weapon which could produce so much of watery kind of thing which could counteract Brahmastra. Such kind of technology we don't find. If there is atomic bomb, nuclear bomb, we don't find technology which can deal with atomic bomb or nuclear bomb. So in that sense, if we try to compare, we find Vedic society, because it was God-centered, there was all-round development. There was development in the consciousness of people, and whatever development was required altogether to make a comfortable life so that we can exist in this world with comfort and at the same time progress in spiritual life. That was the Vedic system. Here we can see what is the difference between Vedic advancement and modern advancement. So we find Vedic advancement, the consciousness was also advanced. Modern culture, we find consciousness is at the level of animals. So much of greed, so much of lust, so much of all the varieties of different kinds of ill qualities we can find. So practically there is no advancement in the terms of quality of values of life. But in the Vedic time we can see even a common man would be very honest. Prabhupada gives the example, even few hundred years back, if somebody's money is lying on the street, nobody will touch it. Yesterday, my daughter was reading a poem from her book that one tree is desiring, better let me be with all kinds of thorns and whatever leaves I have. Because if I imagine, let me have golden leaves, then people are so greedy that they will pluck away all the leaves and I will become ganja. In Hindi it is said thuta. Thuta means, you know, without any leaves, practically everything is gone. It's like when our hairs are gone. You know, it's like that. Then it thought about, okay, if not golden leaves, can I have the leaves made up of glass at least? But then the poem further says that winds will come and that whole glass, everything will break away and everything will be lost again. So actually we can find This is the way of life in the modern life. So earlier, people were so honest, they would not even lock their houses. Because the value system was so high. Simple living and high thinking. That was the whole culture. It's not that Vedic system did not know advancement of material life. They were not inclined, they were not interested. But if required, they could do. That is what Kardama Muni did. He was living because as a saintly person, he did not require a big mansion. Did not require a big castle for himself. So he was living in a simple hermitage. Vedavyasa, the author of Vedanta Sutra, the author of all the Vedic literature, he was living in a simple hermitage. And in spite of living in such a simple hermitage, such a great knowledge is produced. This is the difference. So consciousness of people was highly developed. That was the difference. Materially, let us see now, we may be thinking, okay, consciousness-wise they were developed, fine, very good. What about material comforts of life? Now you can see in today's different purports Prabhupada is explaining, we may be very proud of our architectural different kinds of talents we are having. But do we have this kind of architectural talents like Kardama Muni had? We may produce a very nice building, but our flooring will be all of earth only, mud only. Some stones we may use, granite stones we may use. That's all we can do. Have we seen flooring done of emerald, corals, diamonds? Here we can see the toranas, the gate is made up of gold. Hema toranai. That was the kind of advancement even in the Vedic culture. You see. Then Prabhupada is giving the example that even few hundred years back, even Mughals, even they had that kind of architectural skills. Of course, not compared to what was in the Vedic time. But even they were more flourishing than what we are today in our modern culture. They did not require these artificial lamps and lights. Their walls will be with different kinds of diamonds, and in that some special stones will be put. And with that special stone, there will be so much lighting, they don't require bulb. Prabhupada is giving exact example. That today that architectural, that art we can see, but authorities have taken away those valuable, stones. And they've kept them in treasury somewhere. But otherwise, few hundred years back also we can see so much development was there. So here, Prabhupada, in today's purport, is explaining something very nice. Prabhupada is saying here, Kardama Muni, being a saintly person, was living in a humble hermitage. Actually, what is favorable for devotional service, what is favorable for spiritual advancement is actually what should be accepted. That is also the important principle which is given by Srila Rupa Goswami. He says, one should accept everything favorable and should be ready to reject anything unfavorable. In Krishna consciousness, whether as a grahastha or as a brahmachari, we should learn this simple living and high thinking. Because if we want to lead a life which is filled with different material comforts of life, we are not in a position like the great personalities, like the Kshatriyas, the Pandavas, who could live in such great palaces and still maintain their consciousness. We will see in the further verses, Kardama Muni's consciousness was never affected even while living in this great castle. This is very important. Our consciousness will become dragged, it will get carried away. So for us, it is advised that we lead a simple life and we engage our thinking in higher subject matter. And specifically, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has warned that these two things, money, wealth, and woman, attraction for opposite sex, these two are great hurdles in spiritual life. And if one associates with people who are after money and women, then we can understand our spiritual life can be completely spoiled. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would even say, sometime it is better to be surrounded with fire than to be surrounded with people who are materially inclined. This is very important. But sometimes we should not misunderstand this. We should not think distinction between Krishna conscious brahmacharis, Krishna conscious grahasthas, Krishna conscious sannyasi. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said all of them are externals. Kiva vipra, kiva nyasi, shudra kene naya. I am none of them. I am not a sannyasi. I am not a brahmachari. I am not a grahastha. We should not become attached to the different attires which are external, which may be required according to time, place and circumstances. For somebody, grahastha life may be favorable. For somebody, brahmachari life may be favorable. But if both of them are Krishna conscious, there is no distinction. One should not create a wedge between the different ashramas who are practicing Krishna consciousness. Once it so happened, at the time of Prabhupada, Damal Krishna Goswami, he was one of the topmost book distributors of his time. He was having a Radha Damodar party in which practically they were selling so many books. Every day, thousands of books were going. So Damal Krishna, he had developed a kind of a mentality thinking, grahasthas are useless, we have to maintain them. So better to remain brahmacharis, and we should have only brahmacharis and sannyasis associated with the temple. So he tried, he passed a law in the GBC that practically grahasthas will not be entertained in Krishna consciousness. That is the kind of thing he was dwelling on. And then somehow some of the grahasthas, devotees of Prabhupada, they were very dissatisfied with this kind of resolution which was passed in the GBC, and they brought it to Prabhupada. Then Prabhupada not only scrapped the whole thing, he understood that actually this kind of mentality will create a wedge between the different ashramas. Superficially, they will think themselves to be superior. The sannyasi will think, I am superior in terms of Krishna consciousness. No. He is superior in the terms of the different ashramas which are practiced. It is very much possible that Ramananda Raya could preach to a sannyasi. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was in a higher order of life. He was a sannyasi and he should be respected by all other orders. There is no doubt about it. That's a social etiquette. But in terms of advancement in spiritual life, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to point out that Ramananda Raya, he is my spiritual master. I'm learning from him. And when Ramananda Raya was hesitating, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Kiba vipra kiba nyasi shudra kene naya. Yehi Krishna tattva vetta sehi guru haya. That is important. So we should be very, very particular that actually we are not behind, we have given up some kinds of designation, we should not become too attached to another designation. That is also very important. We should not become attached to I am Brahmachari, saffron color. People give me respect. No. We should not become attached to such kind of designations. We should be attached to Krishna consciousness. That is very important. So sometime it may happen, and it's a fact. This is how the material world works. That Brahmachari may think grahasthas are fallen. We should not associate with them. No. That is not what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is teaching. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is teaching, don't associate with materialistic person. A person attached to woman and wealth. That is important. So all these things have to be properly understood. So we can see that even in the Vedic system, the importance was given to the development of our spiritual life, the consciousness. That was important. And along with the consciousness, if we see, even in the terms of development of material comforts of life, Vedic life was far superior. So Prabhupada is giving the example. Where are we seeing this example? Where are we seeing? Where is the flooring done with Indra? So we find Kardama Muni, because he was practicing Krishna consciousness, he was in devotional life, he was a saintly person. He did not require a palace, so he never built. He was living in a very humble hermitage. But when it was required, and when it was requested, on the request of his wife, he produced a great mansion. And after producing the great mansion, he was himself mystified. He himself was astonished to see such kind of mystic power, which could produce all these things. So Prabhupada is saying, this is the way of a godly person. Because a godly person realizes that actually everything is God-gifted. That is very important. This is the difference between a demoniac person and a saintly person like Kardama Muni. A demoniac person like Hiranyakashipu, they may also possess such kind of mystic powers. He actually possessed, and he wanted to utilize his mystic power to break the laws of nature. That is what these people do. With their advancement in material science, they want to break the laws of nature, not to follow the laws of nature. What he wanted to do? Ravana, he wanted to construct a staircase from earth directly to heavenly pleasure, to heavenly planets. Why you require to perform sacrifices? Why tapasya is required? I have already done enough of tapasya. Now I have got the result. With this, now I will change the laws of nature. Nobody needs to do any kind of tapasya to go to heavenly planets. I will make a staircase, golden staircase. This is the difference. They don't understand that all these mystic powers, all these different kinds of powers which a person has got, they're all God-gifted. That is the difference. So, one important thing about a saintly person is he recognizes this is God-gifted. It must be utilized in his service. Demoniac people think it is earned by me. I did it. It is earned by me. So, I must utilize it my sense enjoyment and the extension of mine, aham mameti, their sensual enjoyment. That is what they think. So, this is a big difference. Actually, a devotee very clearly understands the source of all mystic power is Yogeshwara Krishna. Anybody remembers in today's conversation? We read about this. Guru Kripa, what did we read? Haridam? Okay, I will read this. Prabhupada, first of all, he is saying, that is, Krishna is saying, Pashya Adityan, Adityan, plural number. not only one number, plural number. Aditya means actually sun. There is not just one sun. There are many, many suns. For every universe, one sun. But yes, but there are billions of universes. So there are many, many suns. Dr. Patel, Surya and all those 12 suns. Rupad, yes, Aditya. So here, they cannot estimate influence of one Aditya, one sun. In material world, in this universe, we cannot even estimate the power of one sun. Correct? So huge. Day and night, without stopping, millions of years, giving heat and light. Just imagine. We are struggling so hard for electricity, just to lighten one city. And if petrol gets over, all our civilization is finished. Electric civilization will be finished. But see the mystic power of the Lord. Millions of suns. And one sun itself we cannot estimate. How much heat and light it is giving. All lives are sustained by it. All planets in that universe are sustained by sunlight. Even scientists are agreeing. Everything is centered around. So Prabhupada is saying, and here he is showing all of the Adityas. Dr. Patel within him, Prabhupada within him, that is Yogeshwara. So, and then further Prabhupada is saying, Adrishta, the Lord is showing to Arjuna whatever he had seen earlier, whatever he had experienced earlier, he also showed certain things which he had never seen, ever experience. That is the mystic opulence of the Lord. So, in one of the conversations, very nicely Prabhupada explains how the Lord actually is the source of all mystic powers. That is the way of a God-gifted person. He understands my power of my speech. It's like Dhruva Maharaj, he actually recognized this. He said, my dear Lord, before your mercy came, all my senses were only sleeping. Now, after you have touched me, all my senses have become awakened. It's a fact. So, everything. And then after that, Dhruva Maharaj recited so beautiful prayers. So Prabhupada very nicely explains about this. Prabhupada, yogis are mainly concerned with developing different mystic powers. So this is generally what the yogis are thinking. But here we find Kardama Muni is surprised. Because he was never thinking about developing mystic powers. He himself is surprised at having so many powers. And Prabhupada is saying that is the nature of a God-gifted person. He understands. It's like even Hanuman, just by chanting the name of Lord Rama, he was able to cross over the whole ocean. Right? That is also mystic power. Lord Hanuman also had that mystic power. He could jump. But he also never actually remembered any of his mystic power. But when it was required in the service of the Lord, yes, he remembered. And utilized that mystic power to jump and go across. So then Prabhupada is saying, yogi can walk on the water without drowning. Actually, it's a mystic power. You can try this. You drop a needle. What will happen? Drop a needle in the water. It will drown. Okay. But a yogi, with his mystic power, he can walk on the water without drowning. That means he is able to negate gravitational force. He is able to negate that. The law of gravity does not operate on him. That is a mystic power called Laghima. Laghima means person can become lighter than cotton and counteract the laws of gravity. So he can develop that mystic power, that he can counteract the law of gravity. Yoga system simply develops inconceivable potency already present in the practitioner. This is very important. He has not imported or exported from somewhere. It is present in himself. It is God gifted. He simply practices it and develops it. One must recognize this. It's very important. Then Prabhupada is giving an example. These boys are swimming, gesturing to surf bathers. So there were people in the, you know, Prabhupada, this is a morning walk. So Prabhupada is walking near the beach. So there are, near the beach, there are some boys who are surfing. So Prabhupada is giving the example. These boys are swimming, but I cannot swim. Yet, that swimming power is potential within me. It's a fact, right? So, similarly, that yogic power, these mystic powers are potential. Only one has to know the science and practice. Then he can also develop. Yet that swimming power is potential within me. I simply have to practice it. So if yogic power is so potent in human being, think how much more yogic power God has. That is what one should think. If we can have so much of yogic power, how much more God has. Therefore in the Vedas, he is called Yogeshwara, master of all mystic power. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Aham sarvasya prabhavo mattaha sarvam pravartate. I am the source of all material and spiritual worlds. Everything emanates from me. Unless we accept this statement of God, there is no conclusive explanation to the origin of material nature. God cannot be understood without accepting the existence of his mystic power. See, that is very important. So, this is the meaning. Prabhupada, in his conversation with Dr. Swarup Damodar, who was his scientist disciple, he has a very wonderful understanding about how a devotee understands that actually the Lord has created so much mystic power inherent in this material world. Inherent. It is there. So, Prabhupada says that scientists, they are actually thinking chemicals have produced life. But they are not able to show anywhere in their laboratory that they can make chemical combined together. And then they can show that it has produced life. They cannot show. What can they show? They can show chemicals can combine together and produce amino acids, which are the basis of cell construction of the cell. But that is not life. Then, even for the chemicals, Prabhupada asks, even if you say, okay, chemicals have produced life, then who has produced chemicals? Next question should be, who has produced chemicals? That should be asked. And then Prabhupada says, it is very simple to understand who has produced chemicals. Life produces chemicals. In our urine itself, we are producing chemicals. So much mystic power is there. One orange plant, it has so many oranges. There are so many chemicals like citric acid. Right? Now in that seed you cannot find the citric acid, but when it converts into an orange plant and orange fruit, so much citric acid. Can we take in the laboratory, let us take like this and produce citric acid like this. So very wonderful example Prabhupada gives. Another very beautiful, so Prabhupada says a very interesting point from this. Prabhupada is saying, just like we are all small lives are producing smaller chemicals In our urine, we can produce little chemical. Orange fruit can produce some little chemical. That's a small life. Imagine, supreme life can produce how many chemicals? That is a mystic power. Just like there is a mystic power in this body to produce chemical without our knowledge, right? Uric acid is produced without our knowledge. We have no understanding. Similarly, the supreme life can produce so many chemicals. All the chemicals found in nature, all the chemicals found in water, in the atmosphere, in our life, in animals' life, everything is produced by that supreme. That is the mystic power of the Supreme Lord. Then Prabhupada says, similarly, we can also understand this small life can produce little water with our perspiration. We sweat little water, maybe one spoon, one teaspoon we can fill. Supreme life can produce oceans and seas. That is the mystic power of the Lord. Just like he has created mystic power in this material world, that is his mystic power. Then Prabhupada is giving the example. It's a very interesting lesson. Sometime you can read. This comes in Life Comes From Life. There is a chapter called The Lord is the Origin of All Mystic Powers. Then Prabhupada is saying, you are there, you are a life, bird is another life. But bird has a mystic inherent power to fly. You cannot fly. You can try your best, but you cannot fly. But that power is inherent in the bird. It can fly. So that is possible by mystic power of the Lord. What is there in the bird which makes it to fly and which is not there in you which doesn't make you to fly? You cannot remain in the water for more than 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hour, one day. But the fishes can remain in the water with their mystic power whole life. That is the difference. Then Prabhupada gives another wonderful example. Prabhupada says, see how, just see the power, how this body is filled with so much mystical power. Blood. Just by your thinking, the moment you become lusty, the blood converts into sin. Just imagine what kind of mystic power it is. And actually it is said that if one can remain brahmachari and not think about sex life, then the same thing actually, this virya, it goes to the brain. Otherwise, it is going now to the drain. Okay. And that is how you can see how they were very, very sharp in their memory. Because they would not waste their virya like this. This is a mystic power. Just imagine, is it possible? In a laboratory, some machine is thinking and then blood gets transformed into semen. See how it happens. And then Prabhupada is giving another wonderful, see how beautiful example Prabhupada is giving. Prabhupada is saying, cow can eat grass and give you milk. Can you take some grass in your laboratory and give me milk? You produce milk. Isn't it? No dearth of milk will be there. You can take some grass, lot of grass is there, everywhere you can find it. Take some grass and produce milk. See the mystic power, isn't it? And then Prabhupada is further giving example. Okay, in human life itself, you can see you are a man and somebody is a woman. She has a mystic power to produce milk. You cannot produce. So, this is how actually one can understand. So devotee, he actually understands that the Supreme Lord, he is actually the source of all these mystic powers. Just like Krishna is saying, Aham sarvasya prabhavo mattaha sarvam pravartate. And Prabhupada is saying, God cannot be understood without accepting the existence of his mystic power. That is the difference between even Mayavadis and devotees of the Lord. They say there is Brahman, but he has no power. They want to make God devoid of his energies. Devotee says, no, everything is the product, byproduct of the energies of God. Spiritual world is the product of his spiritual energy. Material world is the product of his material energy. It's a byproduct of energies of God. So, this is what we can see from this question. Stop it. This grand class, Bhagavatam,
Namaste.